Christ of Nazareth. Good evening, family of God. We welcome you to this service, this Tuesday night, Miracle Night service. We welcome you, CKM family, and the family of SOTP and United in Christ. On behalf of Pastor Anil Manilal and the pastoral team at Christ Kingdom Ministries, we welcome you to this service. Can we bow our heads and pray? Father God, I come before you in the mighty name of Jesus. I hallow your name and I bless your holy name, O God. For you are the Lord God Almighty, our Jehovah HaMashiach. I praise and I worship and I glorify you, O Father, for there is no one like you, Jehovah. We thank you, Trinity, Holy Spirit, Father God, and Jesus Christ of Nazareth, who is our Lord and Savior. We thank you that we have breath for not yet another day to praise and to worship and to glorify your holy name. I welcome you into this praise, O God, for where your presence is, there is fullness of joy. Father, open your heavens and come and envelop us in your grace and your mercy. I thank you, Jesus, that you will send your angels to be with us today, Father, in the service. We thank you, Lord, because we have you from whence cometh our help. We have you, O God, amen, to praise and to worship and to glorify you, Father. Today I want to take this chance, Father, to come back and say, thank you, Abba God. Thank you, Abba Father, for everything you have done for us. Even in this time, Father God, when there's so much of uncertainty, you are here. I thank you, Lord, for your presence, Father God, because I know that we cannot do anything without you. Bless your people, O God. Where my voice is going, let your people hear and feel the blessings of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Let them know, O Lord, that they have you, O God, and all they have to do is look unto you, to focus unto you, O God, and to praise and to worship and honor you. I thank you, Lord, that as we will bring your word today, I pray for your servant, for your son, who will bring your word. And even if it's for the one person that you have purposed this word for, O God, let that ear hear this word and be set free, Father. Even if you have purposed this entire service, but for one person in this entire earth, let this word go out to that person and heal and help and renew them, O God. I thank you, Lord, now for your presence. And I thank you, O Jesus, that we have you. And as long as we have you, we don't have to fear or to worry about anything. For here on earth, we are but for a season, but we have an eternal life with you. In Jesus Christ of Nazareth's name, I pray, amen and amen. Family of God, the Bible speaks about coming into the courts of the Lord with praise and worship. So let us now praise and worship our God and hallow it and bless his holy name. And thereafter, Pastor Gary will bring you the word of God, which I pray in Jesus' name will find an abiding place in your heart. Amen.
There's a space in every beating heart. There's a longing that reaches past the stars. There's an answer to every question heart. There's a name. There's a hope flowing through these veins. There's a voice that echoes through the pain. There's an ember ready for the flame. There's a name. We will fix our eyes on the name, Jesus. over fear. There's a light that wipes away all tears. There's a presence that changes atmospheres. There's a name. We will fix our eyes on the
Savior Jesus Christ. So nice to spend this evening with you this day. It's Tuesday night, it's our miracle night, it's a time of prayer and fasting where we stand on the name of Jesus Christ for our breakthrough, for our anointing, for our healing, and for the grace of God in our lives. I greet you once again in the never failing name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Always an honor and always a pleasure to speak to you, to address you this evening. Now I'll be standing on the word of the Lord for a word for you this evening. And the Lord has come through. God always does. Whenever you stand on the name Jesus Christ, He always comes through for you. And during these difficult times, one wonders what can be done to make the situation any better. Is there something that we can do as children of God? Is there something that we can manage as children of God? I mean, surely as children of God, we have the ability to intercede and to change things around. Surely, as children of God, we are empowered to make a difference, to make things happen in our lives. I listened to some of the comments made by some of our people like our health professionals were saying just recently, that we should not just get the disease and get it over with. I mean, some of these things are crazy. Some of these things are ridiculous. People are speaking in bad terms, and disaster seems to be ahead of us. However, if you read the Bible speaks a very different story. God's words of promise and breakthrough are for each and every child of the Most High God. God's word says we are overcomers, and that the children of God shall prevail over every situation. Now you can say to me, how can I make a difference? I am but a humble man. I have no credentials. I have no strength to fight this battle. And I certainly have no strength to overcome this enemy that stands before me. But again, God says different. Look at your Bible and see how God has used ordinary men and women of faith to accomplish extraordinary feats. See how God has taken a simple man and woman of faith, like the girl next door or the guy down the road, and turned them and propelled them into greatness. You see, in the eyes of God, you are a royal priesthood. You are a chosen generation. In God's eyes, you are a soldier in the army of the Lord. Amen. Now, Israel also found itself in troubled times. Ever since they came into the promised land, they were attacked by enemies of all sorts. There was always somebody that was troubling them. It was the Hittites, the Amorites, the Midianites, the Canaanites, the Amalekites. The list of enemies of Israel goes on and on. And whenever this happened, Israel would cry out to God for help and for deliverance. God would then raise up a judge to defend them and to mete out justice against their enemies. But what's amazing about these judges is that they were not really special people. In fact, they were ordinary men and women of faith. And so that's what I want to speak to you about this evening. We're going to talk about the ordinary men and women of God. Ordinary, but mighty in God's hands. And so this evening, I have entitled my message, Judges Arise. Amen. Judges Arise. We take our scripture reading from Judges chapter 6. I'd like you to read the entire chapter so you have an understanding of what I'm trying to say. I'm just going to go over a few scriptures with you though. We're going to start from Judges 6 verse 2. And the hand of Midian was strong against Israel. Before the faces of Midian, the sons of Israel made themselves dens in the mountains and caves and strongholds. And so it was when Israel had sown that the Midianites came up, and the Amalekites and the sons of the east, even they came up against them. And they camped against them and destroyed the increase of the earth until you come to Gaza. And they left no food for Israel, neither sheep, nor ox, nor ass. For they came up with their cattle and their tents, and they came as locusts for multitude. Both they and their camels were without number. And they entered into the land to destroy it. And Israel was made very poor because of the Midianites. And the sons of Israel cried out to Jehovah. And it happened, when the sons of Israel cried to Jehovah because of the Midianites, Jehovah sent a man, a prophet, to the sons of Israel, who said to them, "So says Jehovah, the God of Israel, I brought you up from Egypt, and I brought you forth out of the house of bondage, and I delivered you out of the hands of the Egyptians, and out of the hand of all those that oppress you. And I drove them out from before you, and gave you their land." Now let's recap the events that transpired here. Israel was being persecuted and oppressed by the Midianites. The Midianites were the sons of Abraham and Keturah. They were a nomadic people who lived east of the Jordan River. So great was this persecution that the children of Israel hid themselves in caves and in dens in the mountains. The Bible says, whatever Israel had sown or planted or harvested from the earth, the Midianites, the Amalekites would come and steal it all. They would steal the harvest, they would steal the oxen, they would steal the sheep. In fact, the Midianites would take everything. So great was the plunder that the Bible says Israel would have no food to eat. And that's where we get our famous scripture from, of Gideon threshing grain in a winepress. Now, why was Gideon threshing grain in a winepress? The answer is simple. Because if the Midianites saw him, they would come down and steal his food. The Bible says the enemy of Israel was so great that they were without number. Or put another way, they could not be counted. Israel was made poor because of this thievery. And the Bible records in verse 8, the sons of Israel cried to Jehovah because of the Midianites. Now, Israel's situation is not unique. You and I, we find ourselves in a similar situation. Sickness comes to rob us of our health. You work hard, and then somebody comes along and snatches the fruit of your labor. The labor of your hands is taken away from you. The devil robs you of your peace and your joy. The Bible puts it this way. The Bible says in John 10:10, the thief comes only to rob, to kill, and to destroy. That's his only purpose, and he does not stop. No, church. We all have our own Midianites to deal with. We all have our own Midianites to contend with, to battle with. And so in verse 8, Israel cries out to God for deliverance. Now watch what happens. Let's continue with our reading. Now God begins to speak to Gideon. Judges 6 verse 11. And the angel of Jehovah came and sat under an oak which was in Ophrah, which belonged to Joash the Abizite. And his son Gideon threshed wheat by the winepress to hide it from the Midianites. Verse 12. And the angel of Jehovah appeared to him and said to him, Jehovah is with you, mighty warrior. And Gideon said to him, O Lord, if Jehovah is with us, why then has all of this happened to us? And where is all his miracles which our fathers told us about, saying, did not Jehovah bring us up from Egypt? But now Jehovah has forsaken us and delivered us into the hands of the Midianites. Now, does this not sound familiar, church? Tell me, does this not sound familiar? Don't we all do this, church? As soon as something goes wrong, we start complaining. Oh God, where are you? God, why have you forsaken me? Lord, how could you do this to me, Lord? That's what the children of Israel did before this as well. Even before they left Egypt, they started complaining. Lord, you brought us out of Egypt to kill us in the wilderness. Lord, we had nice food to eat in Egypt. Now we have no meat. God forgive us, church. God forgive us. But it's true. We all do exactly that. Judges 6 verse 14 says, And Jehovah looked upon him and said, Go in your might, and you shall save Israel from the hands of the Midianites. Have I not sent you? Have I, God, not sent you, Gideon? Notice, God commissions Gideon to become a judge and to save Israel. Let me say that again. God commissions Gideon to become a judge and to save Israel. But notice what Gideon does. Gideon pulls a Moses. He starts making excuses. Gideon does a Jonah. He starts to duck and dive. Judges 6 verse 15 says, And Gideon says to God, Oh my Lord, what shall I save Israel with? Behold, my family is poor in Manasseh, and I am the least in my father's house. Verse 16, God says to him, Surely I will be with you, and you shall strike the Midianites as one man. So what has happened here, church, is that the Midianites were persecuting and oppressing the people of Israel. And so God has commissioned Gideon and made him a judge over Israel. God has commissioned Gideon to deliver Israel from the oppression of the Midianites. Gideon and his 300 men then go out and wage war against Midian. And in that battle, more than 120,000 enemy troops are killed. You can read that in Judges 8, verse 10. Today, church, I declare over you that you are a judge in your situation. God has called you. God has anointed you. God has commissioned you. God has dedicated you to destroy your enemies. In and through God, you are destined for greatness. Your circumstances may seem bad, but your future is much brighter. God has given you every talent you need, every skill, and even great strength to overcome. God has made you a judge over your situation. Don't put yourself down. Rise up and declare God's judgment over your enemy. Amen. Now listen to what God is saying about you. Listen carefully. Judges 6 verse 8. God says to Gideon, I brought you up from Egypt and brought you forth out of the house of bondage. Now, church, this is God speaking to you personally. This is what God has to say about you and about you. Listen, God is saying you are special. God is saying out of all the millions of people on this earth, I chose you. God is saying I commissioned you, I ordained you, and I made you special. God is saying, I made you even in my own image. You see, church, we put ourselves down. We give the devil too much of credit. The devil did this, the devil did that. You put too much of salt in the food, well, the devil made me do that too. No, no, no. We do it to ourselves. We put ourselves down, we discredit ourselves, we lower our self-esteem, and we reduce our personal worth. That's exactly what Gideon did. God commissioned Gideon as a great warrior of God. But how did Gideon see himself? Gideon says, how can I save Israel? Gideon says, I come from a poor family in Manasseh. I am the least in my father's house. Let me tell you something, church. What the Lord says about you is more important than what you think of yourself. Let me repeat that. What the Lord says about you is more important than what you think about yourself. In fact, what the Lord says about you is more important than what other people think of you as well. They did the same thing to Jesus. In John 1:46, they said, can any good thing come out of Nazareth? Do you see how people judge? The Lord says, today I am with you to make you a great and a mighty warrior. When the Lord is with us, church, we have nothing to fear, and we can believe in God for great and mighty things. So today, this evening, I commission you as a judge over your situation in Jesus' mighty name. Whatever it may be, today I declare in Jesus' name that you, as a man or as a woman of God, are now a judge ordained for great purpose. Now I want you to go and take control of your situation. Whatever it is, you take that bondage and you put it under your submission. Whatever chain holds you down, you break it this evening. I pronounce judgment over you, Satan, and I declare you will hold me in bondage no longer. Amen.
Amen.
Now the thing about a judge is that he has power and he has authority. A judge can make you rich, he can make you poor, he can curse you, or he can bless you. A judge has power and he has authority. A judge can find judgment in your favor, in which case you can win a huge settlement and you can become a rich man. Alternatively, he can find against you, make you pay a fine, and then you will become poor. A judge can punish you with a long jail sentence, in which case you will be cursed. Or alternatively, that same judge can waiver the sentence, in which case you will be set free and you will be blessed. There is power and there is authority in the name of Jesus Christ. The Bible says every knee and every tongue must confess the name of Jesus Christ. Today, I prophesy over you that you are your own judge in Jesus Christ's mighty name. I prophesy and I declare the power of Jesus Christ be upon you. The authority of Jesus Christ be upon you. It is yours to win over every situation. Amen. Now Joshua was also commissioned by God to become a judge. God says to Joshua in Joshua 1:5, no man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail you, nor will I ever forsake you. Now, in case you missed that, church, that is a promise and an undertaking from the Lord. It stands true in good times, and it also stands true in difficult times. This fact should be the bedrock and the foundation of our lives. Never doubt God's word. Never doubt His word. Always love and embrace the great love that God has for you. The Lord's constant presence is something that we can be sure of. Look what God says to Joshua, all the days of your life. Today, church, God is saying the very same thing to you. I will be with you all the days of your life. Now, that's a good place, church, to say amen. God is there to carry us forward and to lift us up. God's faithfulness for us is sure. He will never leave you. He will never fail you, nor will He ever forsake you. Our prayer should be, Lord, I rejoice in your enduring love, in your faithfulness, Lord, towards me. Lord, I rejoice because you are the one, Father, who goes before me to make the crooked path straight. Not only that, Lord, but you also walk with me in the back to make sure I don't stumble and I don't fall. That should be our prayer. Now, God pronounced judgment over the city of Jericho in Joshua 6, verse 20. Now, Jericho was a fortified city. It was said that the walls of Jericho were impenetrable. In fact, when armies came up against Jericho, the people would laugh at them. That's how much of trust and faith they had in those walls. So much trust they had in those walls. But when God's judgment is passed, then nothing can stand against you. When God's judgment is passed, then everything must come under submission. Every chain must be broken and every wall must come crumbling down. God pronounced his judgment over Jericho. And at the sound of the trumpet blast, and at the sound of a mighty roar from God's men and women, the great walls of Jericho came tumbling down. Today, I declare, in Jesus' name, you are a judge over your situation. I pronounce judgment this day over your enemy, and I bring him under your submission. Pronounce judgment over your sickness, and bring it under submission. Pronounce judgment against a strong man, and bring him under your submission. Now, you know what the interesting thing happened just before Jericho? Just before they can get to the city of Jericho, something very interesting happened. Watch this in Joshua 5 verse 13. Joshua saw a man with a drawn sword standing before him. And Joshua asked him, "Are you for us or are you against us?" And the man replied, "I am the commander of God's armies." Let me tell you something, church. If God is for you, then who can be against you? The battle you fight is a judgment that God has pronounced over it. God will pronounce judgment over that situation. Amen. Now, in Daniel chapter 3, there is a remarkable story. Daniel chapter 3, there is a remarkable incident that takes place here. King Nebuchadnezzar has made a golden image of himself. And he has pronounced a decree. He has said that there will come a time when the musicians will play the harp and the flute. They will make music. And as soon as you hear the sound of the music, the people are expected to fall to the ground and to start worshiping that golden image. As soon as they hear the music, they must all fall to the ground and worship that golden image. Of course, the three Hebrew boys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, refused to obey and to worship this image. Now the Chaldeans, a lifelong enemy of Israel, go and tell the king about this. "Mr. King, the three Hebrew boys will not bow down to your golden image." And so the boys are summoned to appear before the king in the king's court. Now what we have here, church, is basically a trial taking place. We have here a court case that is being played out. The Chaldeans are the witnesses. The three Hebrew boys are the defendants. And King Nebuchadnezzar is the judge. "Is it true," asked the king, "is it true that you refuse to bow down to my image? Is it true? If it is, then I find you guilty. And you will be thrown into the fiery furnace." What did King Nebuchadnezzar do? He pronounced judgment on the three Hebrew boys. Now watch this. Nebuchadnezzar is a fake. He is a phony. He has no power. He has no authority to judge the children of Israel. Only Jesus Christ can do that. Now watch how the three Hebrew boys reply. In Daniel chapter 3 verse 16, they say, "Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered the king and said, 'O king, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If there were a case, then our God, whom we serve, will rescue us.'" Amen. What a statement of boldness and courageousness. The boys turned the table around and passed judgment on the king. Today, you are a judge over your situation. God has made you a judge over that fiery furnace. I declare the fourth man is with you today. I declare that fire that comes against you will not burn you, nor will any fake king make a judgment against you. Today I declare that the doctor's report, I pass judgment on that report. It is false. You will not die. Today I declare over the banker's report, it is false. I pass judgment against it. My business will not fail. Arise, O kings. Arise, O judges. And bring your enemy to submission. Amen. Now, you say to me, "Hey, Pastor G, that's all well and good, but how do I do this? How do I become a good judge? What exactly should I do?" Well, Gideon gives us some good examples and pointers. Let Gideon demonstrate some good leadership skills this evening. Let's look at some of them. Number one, Gideon declines to lead unless God calls him first. Gideon acts only when God tells him to do so. Remember, our strength comes from God. So don't be a macho man and try and do it by yourself. Wait on God. Number two, Gideon depends on God at every turn. Gideon places his faith on the one and only true God, our God, Jehovah. As long as God is with him, Gideon cannot fail. Now when God commissions Israel to fight, 32,000 Israeli men turned up to fight the Midianites. But God said that was too many. Keep just 300 men. Remember, the Bible says that the Midianites were like locusts, so many they could not be numbered. Gideon didn't panic, nor did he run in fear. He depended on God. Later on, those 300 men would kill 120,000 enemy soldiers. Number three, he turns faith into action. Many of us have faith, but no action. Many of us have faith, but no action. James says, faith without action is of little use. We must put our trust in the work of God. Take the initiative. Take charge of your situation. Gideon cuts down the altar of Baal and worships Jehovah instead. Can we do the same, church? Number four, he uses the gifts of God that God has given him to lead others, telling the 300 who stuck with him, watch me and follow my example. In Judges 7:17, he says, as I do, you shall do. Number five, he gives God all the glory before and after the victory. Number six, he humbly gives others credit that belongs to him. You see, even though it was Gideon and God who won the battle, the Ephraimites came to him and said, why did you not call us to fight this battle for you? Gideon was humble and said, hey, Ephraim, you are better than me. Amen. Number six, number seven, he refuses to establish a dynasty after he has fulfilled God's purpose. After he won the battle, the people asked Gideon, they said, Gideon, you and your sons, come and rule over us. Be our king. Gideon refused. In Judges 8:23, he said, I will not rule over you, neither shall my son rule over you, nor only Jehovah shall rule over you. Amen. Now you may feel that you are an ordinary man or woman of God, but in God's eyes, you are special. Judges 6:23 says, peace to you, do not fear. You shall not die. The angel of the Lord here is speaking to Gideon. Gideon seriously doubts. He seriously doubts that he is the right man to lead the Israelites into battle against the Midianites. Hiding in a wine press, Gideon is paralyzed by fear of the enemy and a low self-image. You see, you and I are the same. We look down on ourselves. We don't consider ourselves to be qualified to do God's work. We always think and feel that somebody else can do it better than us. Yet these are the kind of people that God uses for his glory. The angel says to Gideon, do not fear. Now the words, do not fear, this command appears more than any other in scriptures. God chooses people who know that they need God. God chooses people who know that they need God. He does not choose those who think they can do it themselves. Remember, church, there is no plan B. There's only God's way. Amen. I want to conclude now. God chose 12 judges to rule over Israel's enemies. Each judge came from each of the 12 tribes. First came the judges, then came the kings. God elected kings to rule over and to protect the people. Some judges did well, others failed. Some kings did well, others failed. God needed someone better than all the kings, and so he chose his only son, Jesus Christ. You see, Jesus is the ultimate and final king and judge. King of kings and Lord of lords. The Father invested all authority and all power into his final judge, the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And so, as children of God and disciples of Jesus Christ, we have the all-powerful judge to look after us. Trust only in him, church, and all your enemies will come into submission. In John chapter 7, verse 30 to 31, the Bible says, at this time, they tried to seize him, but no one laid a hand on him, because his time had not come. Still many put their faith in him. Jesus submitted voluntarily to be crucified on the cross. I want to repeat that. Jesus submitted voluntarily to be crucified on that cross. There was none who could force him to do it. The power of God was always with Jesus. That same power is given freely to you in Jesus' name. Use it. Declare it. Proclaim it over every situation, over every circumstance, and over every enemy. And I declare in Jesus' name, you will prevail. Remember, under the blood, power, and authority of Jesus Christ, you are made a judge over all your enemies. And so, men and women of God, proclaim judgment this evening. Proclaim judgment over your enemies and claim your victory. Amen. Can we stand this evening as we get ready for prayer? Lord, we come to you this evening, Father, in the never-failing name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord, I thank you, Lord, for your Son, the one who is and the one who is yet to come, the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last. We come this evening, Father, freely, Lord, to worship this Son. We come this evening, Father, freely to submit to our King and to our Judge this day. Father, I declare, in Jesus' name, Father, no enemy shall come before your people this day. Father, I declare in Jesus' name, every chain, Father, be brought under submission this evening. Father, I pray in Jesus' name, every enemy shall be brought under submission in Jesus' name. Today, Lord, in Jesus' name, I take authority and I declare judgment over that sickness that afflicts our people. I come against you in Jesus' mighty name. I declare your report is null and void. I declare the doctor's report is a lie. It is phony. The word of the Lord shall prevail. I declare judgment over you, sick men and sick women. You shall be healed in Jesus' mighty name. Today I proclaim judgment against the strong man, the one who comes to rob, to steal, and to destroy. Today I bind you up in Jesus' name with a threefold cord, and I cast you into the deep, never to return. I pronounce judgment over you, Satan. You shall have no hold upon my people. You shall have no hold upon their families. You shall have no hold upon their business. You shall have no hold upon their health. I pronounce judgment against you in Jesus' mighty name. I declare this day that the word of the Lord is A and amen. I declare this day that judgment is pronounced over the Midianite. You shall not steal from the children of God. You shall not attack or come against them, the children of God. I declare in Jesus' name that no weapon of war shall pass through your land. I come against the sword, I come against the bow, I come against the shield. I declare in Jesus' name, these things shall have no effect upon you, upon your household, or upon your family, in Jesus' mighty name. I declare judgment, Lord, over the thief that comes to steal, to rob, and to destroy. I declare judgment over the one who speaks lie and innuendo against our people. I come against you, in Jesus' mighty name. I declare this day that the threefold blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit is our protection. I declare this day that the threefold blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit is the grace of God over our lives. And so this evening, Father, I pronounce your blessing over your people, Father. I declare this day, welcome them, Father, under the shelter of your wings. Father, welcome us this day, Father, into the comfort of your feathers. Build a hedge of fire around us, Father, that no enemy will prevail. Build a hedge of fire around us, Father, like you did for Job, Lord. I pray this day, Father, we shall lose nothing. I pray this day, Father, multiplication will come upon your family. Whatever the devil has taken, Lord, I pass judgment on him, and I declare you shall return it back 1,000 times over in Jesus' mighty name. Father, you are our strength. Father, you are our blessing. Father, you are the grace of God in our lives. We love you, Father. We love you, Lord. We respect you, Lord. We honor you, Lord, for who you are and for what you have done. This day, Father, we submit to the final authority, the name of Jesus Christ. This day, Father, we submit to the ultimate authority, the name and the power of Jesus Christ. We give you all the glory, my Father. We give you all the praise, Lord, for there is none like you. We come before you this day, Father, in the threefold name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. I bless your house. I bless your people. I bless your families, Father, with your love, with your blessings, and with your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
We will fix our eyes on the one who overcame. Set our eyes on you, Jesus. We'll stand in awe of the one who breaks the chains. We stand in awe. We will fix our eyes on the one who breaks the chains. has laid, Jesus. Oh, love has laid, love has laid, Jesus.